This is Manjula Narayan, books editor, Hindustan Times. And today I have with me Sunetra Choudhury and Sunil Gupta, who've come out with this like really sensational book, Black Warrant, Confessions of a Tihar Jailer. So, well, Sunil Gupta is the Tihar Jailer. And I'll read a bit.
I'm the secret keeper.
Yes.
And storyteller.
A railway man with a higher calling, inquisitive Sunil Gupta was assisted by a familiar face when he secured a new job at Tihar. He only realized on the way out that it was arch-criminal and highly high-functional psychopath Charles Sobhraj, star of Prison, where the cons ran the show. Gupta would also become a lifer, remaining for over three decades in a place where beatings were bread and butter and breakfast was hunger strikes called by the wronged who were seeking rights. This is a book of revelations. What is life like inside Asia's largest prison? What happens when a man is hanged, but his pulse refuses to give up even after 2 hours? Did Nirbhaya's rapist, Ram Singh, commit suicide, or was he murdered? For the first time, we have a riveting account from an insider who breaks his silence about all he's seen. How the most poorly judged and infamous in contemporary Indian history, the least known and most chastised criminals and conspirators in the subcontinent, the guilty and the framed, from Sobhraj via Afzal Guru, lived and died. Award-winning journalist Sunetra Choudhury has captured an extraordinary life lived in a most secretive institution. A book of secrets and surprises. Read Black Warrant. Seriously, read Black Warrant. Let's start with the Nirbhaya, case where Ram Singh, it was put
he committed suicide. So-called suicide.
But you say that he was actually murdered. So, talk about that.
Basically, you know what happened in the early hours of the day when it was so-called suicide. I went there. I saw that his body was hanging from around 12 feet high grills. There was a bucket lying which could be of 2 feet height. And he was just hanging, and there were four more inmates inside that cell. When I asked those co-mates that how he has committed all this when you were here, they told me, no, sir, pata nahi laga, kaise ho gaya, hum log so rahe the. I said, it is not possible. At that time, I was having suspicion that it is something more than suicide. And when postmortem report came, I find there in the viscera report, there was contents of alcohol in the viscera. So how the alcohol can reach to the person like of the status of Ram Singh? So my suspicion was confirmed after seeing this viscera report, and plus also seeing that when there were four others, how can someone commit suicide?
Yes.
My view is that it was not a suicide, but it was
definitely
murder.
When I was working on my first book, it was all about people inside and their stories. But you needed just a little bit of perspective before it went to thing. I went to see him. And that's when he told me that, you know, I can speak to you now because I'm now retired. And why it's important is that, you know, for 35 years, he'd totally, completely fobbed off and tried to make us all think that everything was fine in Tihar, you know. You would call him
it's
up and say,
it's a happy place.
No, so it takes you time, right? It takes you time to process. And I think some of the things what fascinated me, because I also thought, okay, look, I've written a book about Tihar. How different can it be?
Oh, but this is very different.
Isn't it? Yeah, exactly. So because in one way, it's also the fact that in the previous book, it was the people who were incarcerated. And here suddenly you have the story of the person who is incarcerating the jailer. And the thing is, I think all of us think that the jailer, and rightly so, is this monster. And then you have this happy smiling man. You know what I mean? And I think that just the humanizing aspect of it, the fact that, you know, he brings up cross and he talks about his family, and imagine living in this atmosphere of where you're surrounded by, well, really the most unseemly characters in society, but some also really perhaps unluckiest people. So I think that by itself made a fascinating story.
Hmm. In the book, you come across as a decent man surrounded by all sorts of like crazies.
The primary function of the jailer is to do a lot for the reformation of the prisoner. So, we can reform the prisoner if you yourself are reformed. It was in year 1993. Earlier also, we used to have these meditation courses inside for the prisoners. After 1993, it was a regular feature. It was because of, you can say, charismatic personality of Kiran Bedi, that a number of NGOs who are conducting meditation courses like Vipassana, Art of Living, and so many, they approach us to have their meditation courses. I myself have gone through all these courses. So that was the major thing, that I have keep myself this cool and composed.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. I found that in the book, like, you've made your opinions about DGs clear. Without actually saying it. You know, you're full of admiration for Kiran Bedi. Rightly so, but Vimla Mehra,
she was also there.
She doesn't come out very well in the book, and especially in the Ram Singh suicide/murder. You know, the suggestion is that she didn't put him. She let him out. To be killed.
Basically, this was my impression. You know, whenever some infamous person or gangster or hi-fi criminal came to the prison, you know, our first consideration was where to keep that person, where to lodge that person. So, when we heard from the newspaper that they are going to come to the prison, then I suggested the DG prison, because I was simply an advisor, nothing more, having no executive powers. So, I advised her ki we should keep madam, isko hum high security ward mein rakh dete hain. Then she told me, no, let where their alphabet, basically we are keeping the prisoners as per their first name alphabet. If somebody is Ramesh, he will go to the R alphabet, where people of R alphabet are kept. Like if someone is Sunil, we will keep that person where S alphabet people are come. There might be different jails. So, applying that general formula, she directed that they should
even
be kept.
Even though it's a highly sensitive case.
They should be kept in the alphabet where their name fall, and no special security measures. I was dismayed to hear this. She was also very disturbed when with Nirbhaya the case. She was very disturbed. She was appearing in various channels, in NDTV also. I saw her.
So I thought it was interesting that despite the fact that, you know, Sunil Gupta has a huge amount of, like, you know, he's obviously disturbed as the father of a daughter or any kind of, as a human being, hugely disturbed by what this man did. But I think his point was, whoever it is, we should do our job in providing them what the jail book says. And the jail book says that if he is prone to being attacked, then we have to protect him. And I think that wasn't provided in that DG's term. And I think that's what the book wanted to point out, that how everyone was so influenced by the media and by public perception that she said, I mean, what we quote her as saying is saying, he pointed out in the meeting, ki madam, unko maar dalenge. Unko maar ne do. So that, I think, is a shocking aspect.
She forgot her duty. You know? It was her duty.
She did it obviously because she became emotional. But should a police officer who is heading the most largest prison, should they be forgetting this and be allowed to get swayed by their emotion?
Basically, I have written in my acknowledgement that even Gandhiji has said this, that you hate the sin, not the sinner.
Not the sinner.
Our laws are wonderful. You know, they are humane. It's true. They are humane, and, you know, because we are, you know, part of international treaties which, you know, cater to human rights. So, on paper, it looks wonderful. However, jails are these little islands which are cut off from outside. So, inside, the jailer can do whatever he wants. And sometimes they do whatever they want. So, that is scary.
Yeah, yeah.
What is happening even now, if somebody wants to mistreat someone, torture someone, they can certainly do it.
Yeah, yeah.
And another the fascinating bit I found was the chapter on hangings. So tell me, these, we were talking about the the hangmen.
Kalu and Fakira, they were the trademark for every hanging in northern India. So, whenever there were hanging, we used to call them. This Kalu, he was employed with this Meerut jail.
Okay.
They were the employee of the prison department.
And you're saying that now they're not
employed? Now there is no one.
There are no hangmen. There's no hangmen.
There are no hangmen. And Fakira was the employee of Patiala jail.
Okay.
So, nowadays, since very few hangings are taking place, so most of the jails have abolished the post.
Okay.
Now, we have to borrow the hangman from other prisons.
Hmm.
And basically, you know, the process is so simple.
Okay.
Hanging in jail manual, step by step, everything is given.
And there's one case where the jail officials had to hang a person.
Basically, you know, our primary motive was that his life is extinct. We have to make sure that his life is extinct.
Hmm.
So, whether by pulling the leg or by... so, now, after
Ranga
this,
Billas,
yeah,
no?
Yeah, in Ranga, Ranga case, basically, you know, if you are hanging someone and if he just hold his breath, then his breath will be completely out. It will take time in making him dead.
So, he was hanging there for 2 hours, alive.
Yeah, after 2 hours, most of the person are dead. But if someone is very slim, then it takes time.
So, a constable had to hang on to his
in
leg?
That case, in that case, it was done. But, you know, now, after this Afzal hanging, there is a very comprehensive ruling of Honorable Supreme Court in Shatrudan Chauhan case.
Yes.
Now, it is mandatory that for every body, for every dead body, you have to make postmortem.
So, you can't pull people's legs.
You can't pull people, yeah.
I think you mentioned something about how horror is relative.
Hmm.
No, there's a specific line in the book, in this chapter.
Yeah.
Horror is relative. And really, when I read the chapter, I thought, you know, it really is relative.
Yeah, sure. Hmm.
Because... No, for them, they had to get the job done.
No, and the thing is, you know, while I was researching it, there are like all kinds of horrors.
Hmm.
I mean, in one, as you were saying, in Rajasthan, they allowed some hanging in a stadium.
Yeah.
In a stadium?
Yeah.
Here, like recently?
No, not recently. It was, I think it was 15, 16 years back.
But that's like really recent.
Yeah.
I thought this was like 30, 40
years
back.
And then if you go through, I went through the Maharashtra prison manual and all of that. And there they used to want to make a public spectacle out of it. You know, they used to go around. I mean, in Afzal's case, of course, they wanted to keep it a secret.
Yes.
But in other cases, you know, there used to be public notices put out and people going around basically saying that, you know, this person is going to be hanged. And it was basically...
They will do manadi. They will do manadi. And
manadi ki zarurat nahi hai, TV.
But, you know, in the Delhi jail manual, even now, there is a provision that if his relative or someone else for study purposes want to see the hanging, superintendent...
Study purposes?
Researchers, of course.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. And the fact that during, you know, what I found fascinating was him saying that how when they were practicing for Afzal and it was, the rope kept breaking.
True story.
The Afzal Guru chapter is very sensitively done, I thought. And that bit about you singing that song with him. So, what was, you know, the emotional situation at that point?
Basically, you know, we have written in the book that I have been witness to 8 hangings. And this was the last hanging of all. I have seen every prisoner their last moment. But the good thing about Afzal was that he was very cool and composed.
Even at the end,
he was very cool and composed. And when a person is saying that he want more tea, first he took tea with us, myself, jail superintendent, other jail staff, they all were there. He first took tea with us. Then he said, ki Sunil ji, main aapko ek gana sunana chahta hun. Sunil ji, matlab superintendent jail bhi, basically, you know, I met him 3 or 4 times in all during his incarceration. So he just saw me. कहें सुनील जी मैं आपको गाना सुनाना चाहता हूँ. मैंने कहा सुनाओ. तो कहता है जिंदगी क्या आप अपने लिए जी रहे हो, कोई जिंदगी थोड़ी है. मैं जो ये जो मुझे फांसी लग रही है मैं दूसरों के लिए जो है जीना चाहता था इसलिए मुझे फांसी लग रही है. एंड सडनली कहना कि आपने वो गाना सुना. मैंने कहा कौन सा. तो उसने वो गाना गाना शुरू कर दिया अपने लिए जिए तो क्या जिए पूरा गाना.
संजीव कुमार.
हाँ पूरा गाना उसने आखिर तक गाया ही वाला. So I was so surprised ki even in the last moments he remember every line of that song. So that impressed me. Plus when he was just going for this for hanging, he told me that Sunil ji aap main na aapki aankhon mein dekhunga. Maine theek hai aap dekhte raho aankhon mein. मुझे आपकी आंखों में ना कंपैशन नजर आ रही है. तो मैंने कहा ठीक है. तो जब उसको जब उन्होंने हैंग किया दिस जेल नंबर 3 अथॉरिटी व्हेन दे हैंग्ड हिम ही वाज जस्ट लुकिंग एट इन माय आईज. तो दैट इज unforgettable. So I was very much you can deeply involved in this process.
So Sunetra, what is the most difficult bit about this book for you?
There are quite a few aspects actually. First of all, just as a, this is a technical thing but a writer's thing as well, how do you become somebody else's voice? So
yes,
for me,
you've done it very well.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm so happy. Yeah. No, because how do you do that? He's such a different person. And I have all my sensibilities. How do you do that without caricature? How do you do it without, you know, and staying true? And yet, what
and
I wanted to do...
his family life.
That we had to, no? Otherwise, it would be so two-dimensional. You had to understand where he was coming from. And for me, that was the most fascinating part. You know, yeah, because... you know, because he was able to convey to me, you know, I could feel the frustration. I'm really looking forward to meeting your wife, by the way. I could feel the frustration of his wife, you know, that... you know, to be surrounded by negativity, I think one of the most key things, and I think for me it was basically to convince myself and that way I could convince the readers. The key thing was when he, when, you know, the nature of this book is when he tells us this joke. Do you remember it? Where he said that, you know, he wanted to talk about how people are negative. So he says that, you know, हमारे यहाँ पे एक बहुत ही there's a joke which is very very common among jailers. And what's the joke? The joke is that God appears and says you can have anything that you want. And you haven't read that bit, okay?
No.
God appears and he says you can have anything that you want. So the, you know, the jailer gets very happy. He's like, yeah, okay, cool. He says, but there is a condition.
Always a but.
Yeah. What is the condition? Whatever you get, your neighbor is going to get double that.
Wow.
Okay. So the guy is like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. So he keeps thinking. And you know what he asks for?
What?
He asks to be blind in one eye. I mean, can you imagine? And it was so, for me, that crystallized... the, you know, the sentiment and the feeling I could understand. See, in my last book, right, in that one you're talking about poor people or, you know, rich people or whatever, but people like you and me who went to jail, it's easy to sympathize with them. How do you evoke sympathy for the jailer? So that was a huge challenge as well, which I think just by showing their vulnerability, you know, and that was my, you know, because otherwise, why would people read? Why would people read about horrible jailers who pull people to kill them? But, you know, it's important to understand that, you know, they are doing a job. They're doing a job that's been entrusted by the state and they're just doing it as best as they can.
You know, also what I found interesting was this, the thing about how earlier prison officials getting married to convicts. That section, what is that? Renu Mukherjee.
Raju Mukherjee. Yeah, basically, you know, why...
Marrying a rapist?
Yeah. I have seen...
Again, the same. You're surrounded by these people, so you're going to fall in love with one of them only, no?
This Raju Mukherjee, she was brought up in this orphanage of government. She was so beautiful. When basically earlier we used to have this old lady matron who were handling the old lady matron, or we were getting the matrons from this rural background who were very rough in speaking. So this was for the first time when I saw the Raju Mukherjee. She was very beautiful, and after around 2 years, this man who is now his her husband, he was the orderly of deputy superintendent. So when she used to go out from the prison, deputy superintendent office is in the at the outer gate, near the outer gate. So I think when she used to go out, then they used to have interaction, and ultimately they married. And I am surprised to see that even now they are going very well.
And you mentioned a couple of cases like that.
Yeah. There have been so many cases. Yeah.
Every page of this made me think, no.
That is true. I agree.
Every page. It was like, what?
I read it as Priya talk last time. What? So go out and get it. Black Warrant, Confessions of a Tihar Jailer. It really is a good read. Very, very good read. And thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you, Manjula.